The forest tradition started out as a peasant movement. We think of peasant movements, we think of peasant uprisings. This was a different kind of peasant movement. Peasants focused on finding ultimate happiness. And John Munn was the son of a peasant. Most of his students were sons of peasants. And looked at from the outside, it would seem very unlikely that that movement could become a major force in revitalizing Buddhism in Thailand. But it was. You can imagine sociologists back in those days looking at it and saying this movement has no chance of succeeding. The Thai government at the time was trying to stamp out any independent movements. And yet here we are. And you notice one of the themes in John Munn's talks, of the few talks that have been recorded, is that your social standing doesn't have any bearing on your potential as a meditator. He said, what you need to be in order to practice is to be a human being. And that's what you are. You've got a human body, you've got a human mind. And that's all the raw material that you need to practice. It's simply a matter of taking what you've got and developing it. This is important to reflect on when you start getting discouraged in the practice, when it doesn't seem to be working. And you look back on your own past failures in one way or another. Sure, those things don't matter. What matters is your application to the practice right now. The mindfulness, the persistence that you bring to the practice, this will make all the difference in the world. We're talking earlier today about two kinds of truths, so the truths of the observer and truths of the will. Truths of the observer are things that you have no role in determining how valid or true they are. You simply observe them. That's your role. You observe them and you try to figure them out. And in that area, elements of faith and will are directed mainly at simply your faith in the usefulness of observation. But the validity of the truth itself is something that's independent of you. Truths of the will, though, are something different. A relationship is a truth of the will. Skills you develop are truth is a truth. Skills you develop are truths of the will. In other words, you have to bring them into being. If you don't bring them into being, they don't happen. They never become a reality. In this area, faith, confidence, conviction make all the difference in the world. If you refuse to get into a relationship until you have all the evidence you need to prove that it's going to work, that relationship will never happen. If you refuse to work at a skill until you get the evidence that it's a worthwhile skill and that you have the capacity for doing it, the skill will never happen. You've got to believe in the skill, you've got to believe in yourself. That's the primary ingredient that will make that skill a truth, a reality. And meditation is a truth of the will. Nirvana at the end of the path is not something you can will, but you can will the truth, the path to nirvana. So you've got to have faith in yourself, you've got to have faith in nirvana. got to have faith in the path that will take you there. In terms of the raw materials you've got, that you've got this human body here. It breathes. You can watch the breath. It's got all the physical parts of the body that you can use to meditate on. Nothing's lacking. And as for the mental requisites, you've got them as well. It's simply a matter that they haven't been developed properly. I mean, intention lies at the basis of everything. As the Buddha once said, everything is rooted in desire. Based on desire comes the intention to actually act on the desire, act toward what you want. And it's intention that determines how you look at your life. The Buddha talks about a quality called appropriate attention. Yoniso manasikara is the Pali term. Basically means looking at things in the right way. And that's something you can will. Looking at things in the right way basically means looking at them in terms of the Four Noble Truths. Looking at the world in terms of suffering and the cause of suffering. The possibility for an end of suffering, and the fact that there's a path of practice leading there. And you look at your mind and see which events in the mind fall into which truth. Where is the suffering in your own mind? It should be there. You don't have to look for it anywhere else. The cause of suffering is right there as well. It's right here in the craving. Look for that as well. And in the looking, you're developing the path. All these things are right here. It's simply a question of how much you're able to keep with the practice. Because there are going to be setbacks, as with any truth of the will. And you can't let the difficulties get in the way. You can't let your doubts get in the way. You want to be observant, you want to be careful, and to that extent, you've got to have a certain amount of skepticism. Not skepticism in your ability, but just skepticism as to what's coming up in the mind that pretends to be a skillful quality, that pretends to be a skillful intention. You've got to look at that very carefully to make sure which of the Four Noble Truths it actually falls under. Is it part of the path, or is it part of what the Buddha calls the path of practice leading to suffering? It comes out of ignorance and craving. That requires that you be very, very perceptive. But you've got to believe in the process, that it is useful to look at your intentions, that you can learn from looking at your intentions. And that by doing so, you can begin to ferret out which ones are trustworthy, which ones are not. Which ones should be cultivated, which ones should be abandoned. So an important part of the practice is keeping up your faith, keeping up your conviction in what you're doing, and your ability to do it. This is a quality that's called emotional intelligence. The ability not to let your discouragement get in the way, not let your missteps get in the way. So you've got to learn how to give yourself pep talks, give yourself encouragement. Keep your values clearly in mind. Don't let the setbacks get you down. Focus on the things that you do right when you need that encouragement. Because this is how truths of the will actually become true. The path, after all, is something fabricated. It's something that you have to put together. And it's not going to happen unless you believe in yourself, unless you believe in the path. So you've got to keep that belief strong. Where the skepticism should come in is when you look at individual events in the mind. You said some of them seem to be skillful, but when you put them to the test, they turned out not to be. Okay, be willing to admit that. Be willing to admit your mistakes, and you'll be able to learn from them. Don't let them be a source of discouragement. Let them be a source of knowledge. The attitude that's willing to learn from your successes and from your failures is what will get you through. So learn how to develop that attitude. Again, that too is a truth of the will. Some people find it easier than others, but it's possible for all of us to develop the proper attitude. As the Buddha said, if it were not possible to abandon unskillful qualities and develop skillful ones in their place, he wouldn't teach people to do just that. But it is possible. Anybody can do it if you set your mind to it. It's the intention that makes all the difference. So learn to be clear in your intentions, clear about your intentions, recognizing which ones you should cultivate, which ones you should drop. So that truth of the path, that fourth noble truth, becomes a reality in the mind. So the third noble truth, the end of suffering, will become a reality in the mind. So nirvana, unbinding, total freedom from suffering, which actually goes beyond the third noble truth. That will be something that you touch right here, as the Buddha says. You touch it with your whole body, with your whole experience. Right now, those are just words. But if you apply yourself to the practice, you can find out for yourself whether there's more to the words than just words. As we chant just now, this is something for wise people to know for themselves. And wise here doesn't mean just knowing books and knowing how to explain things and knowing how to abstract your ideas and make systems out of them. It means looking very clearly at your intentions, being able to tell skillful from unskillful right in your own mind. And looking at your tendency to like to do things that are going to give bad results and not to like to do things that are going to give good results. And develop your ingenuity so you can get around that obstacle. So no matter how much you like to do something or don't like to do something, it's not the issue. That when you see that something will give good results, you follow through with it. If you see something will give bad results, you'll drop it. That's the beginning of wisdom right there. And it's not just the beginning, it's a principle that carries all the way through. We have the example of the Janmun in the whole forest tradition. From the outside, it might have seemed very unlikely that they would be able to find anything special in their practice, but they did. So take heart from their example. As the Buddha once said, if people stick with the path of practice, this world will not be empty of arahants. And we can't guarantee whether other people will stick with the path, but you yourself can guarantee that. If you set your mind to it.